Craig Denson, thanks for stopping by the studio, first
of
all.
Hey, thanks. It was my pleasure.
Yeah. Helen Back, 18th Walt Longmire novel and still going strong. Fabulous, fabulous book. Early responses have been pretty positive,
yeah,
I'm guessing.
Yeah. It's been fantastic. The reviews have been, you know, wonderful for the book. Like, yeah. And I was, you know, it's a different kind of book like than I've done before, like that, which I think is, you know, the challenge, you know, whenever you do a series, you know, to make sure that you're staying fresh and doing something different and don't become formulaic. It's kind of tough. So you're taking chances every time.
Yeah. I want to talk about place because mm-hmm. you're here in South Dakota. This book happens to be set in Montana. Mm-hmm. And, of course, Walt is from Wyoming. Mm-hmm. We kind of claim you as our own because you're always at the Deadwood Festival of Books. And in Montana, they claim you as their own. And, of course, Wyoming has their own. And probably in Texas and North Dakota and Colorado and anywhere else. But there is a sense that this book could be West River, South Dakota. Talk about place and how you sort of think about geography when you're writing.
Well, I'm always, you know, whenever I think about like state lines, I always think there's a good friend of mine, Charles Whiteman, who was a tribal elder in the Northern Cheyenne tribe. Like that, and I remember someone asked him about, you know, the border, you know, between Wyoming and Montana, one specific spot over near, you know, the top edge of the Bighorn Mountains. And he said, you know, I have hunted and I have fished over this entire area, and I have never seen that line that they say is there like that, you know. And so I don't really pay that much attention. To me, the West is the West, you know. And so, you know, you're always trying to be as specific as you can be in a book and with the characters like that. But then there's a universality, I think, that follows along with that, too. You know, some of those small towns, like at I Defy You, like at to be in any one of those three 18 states, like at and be able to tell me exactly which state it is that you're in, because there's a quality to the, you know, the contemporary American West that I think, you know, comes across in the books and with the characters in each book.
And this is a Western. It's mm-hmm. I called it a great American Western. It's a crime novel. It's also literary fiction with syntax and craft and emotion and depth. It's all those things.
Thank you.
How do you think about genre? Do you care? I mean, do you care what it's late, where it's shelved, or?
You know, I'm going to sound like I'm repeating myself in many ways. Like, I don't pay much attention to genre either. Like that, you know. I mean, those boundaries. An awful lot of time, like at the boundaries that you find, you know, are kind of artificial, kind of like state lines. But you know, in the publishing industry, it's much more of a selling point. You know, they really need to kind of like take your book and put it, you know, in one of these genres so that they can sell it. And, you know, obviously, you know, they are their mysteries, like they are their Westerns, they are literary fiction, you know, a lot of different things like that. I think for me, I kind of tend to be a little bit of a writing crow. You know, I tend to go, you know, float around out there, mm-hmm. flying around within all those genres. Like, and if I see something shiny that's nice that I want to use, I swoop down and pick it up and bring it back home to that nest that is that book and then use it. I don't think there are any rules. Like, I don't think there should be. Like that, you know, if you find, you know, the things that, you know, work for you, then you should use them. One of the comments I get an awful lot is there's a lot of humor in the books, like it. And, you know, yeah. One of the big things I get from a lot of law enforcement people that read the books, the thing that they like the best about the books is the humor. You know, they say, well, you know, there's no way that you can do this kind of a job without a sense of humor. It's more important than a, you know, bulletproof vest. You know, it'll get you through the day like that. And so that's kind of a key element for me. But, you know, the literary aspects, the descriptive passages, you know, I mean, the depth of character and all of that, you know, I think that's just good writing, I hope. And that's, there are two genres. I will concede the point that there are two genres, good writing and bad writing. Like, and I think, you know, you hope that you're doing good writing and trying to avoid the bad writing, you know, that crops up every once in a while.
So. Yeah, I was going to ask you about that because, yeah, this is good writing. And one of the pitfalls that writers can fall into is, just very bluntly, you are a white man with female characters, with Native American characters. None of them are sidekicks to Walt Longmire.
No.
They are fully developed, fully realized. They don't need their own book over here because this is their own book.
Thank you.
And you have avoided all cliche.
Thank you.
Did you like grow into that as an author? Were you paying attention to that from the beginning? like, how is that possible, is I want to ask you, because
I think I was.
It's rare. It's exceedingly rare.
Thank you. Look, for me, the characters are always going to be one of the most important aspects of the book, simply because it's going to entertain the thought of, like, what is this book going to be? What kind of an effect is it going to have on these characters? You know, where is it going to place them? And what kind of changes is it going to have in their lives? I think, you know, one of the biggest mistakes that you can make, I think, with a series is when the characters don't evolve. I think you have to have those characters evolve and change over a period of time. And then, of course, you know, you're taking into the possibility that you may alienate your audience in the sense that they don't want those characters to change. They want the same characters every time. But there are enough books out there that, you know, stick with that kind of, of an idea that, you know, I think anybody who wants that can find it. Mm-hmm. And with my characters, you know, I find them, you know, even after 18 years, you know, I've barely plumbed the depths, you know, in hardly any of these characters like that, just simply because I like to think that there's so much there, that's so much more, you know, to go after. And that doesn't, you know, just mean Walt. That means Henry. That means Vic. That means Lucian. That means all of those characters, like that there's just so much more there. And, you know, that gives them a chance, you know, to breathe, you know, when they come on stage, like when they're there, you know, centered in each novel. And there is an ebb and a flow, like it also, when you have an ensemble of characters, that's one of the joys of writing is that, you know, you get to drop some out a little bit and then bring others in. There are two emails that I get after every book comes out. The first one is, you beat up on Walt too much, you need to take it easy on him on the next book, which is interesting, like that, because that means that people actually believe that Walt's real.
Yeah, real,
like,
yes.
He's out there and I'm doing terrible
things
to him.
He needs a break,
Give Walt a break. And then the other one is, there was not enough of my favorite character. Insert name here. Which means, I get the emails where people say, there was not enough Henry in the last book, or there wasn't enough Vic, or, you know, there wasn't, I knew I'd gotten to a certain point when I started getting emails that said there was not enough dog in the last book. Okay, I was like, really? Wow.
So let's catch up listeners or viewers who maybe haven't, or don't know who all these people are, and just say that in the beginning of this book, Walt Longmire wakes up, and the only reason he knows he might be Walt Longmire is because there is a hat with his name in the sweatband, and it fits.
Yes.
And it mostly fits. I mean, it's a little cold,
right,
so it needs some adjustment.
Once it warms up, it's perfect.
But he
fine.
Does not remember who he is.
Right.
He spends most of the book learning the interior of his own mind, and so do we. The interior of Walt Longmire's mind could fill a novel. And 18,
and
19, and 20. What did you learn about this character who is, in fact, a sheriff from Montana?
Wyoming,
South Dakota. That you didn't know already.
Oh, it was a blast. It really was a joy to write this book. It was fun. It was different. You know, I knew that it was going to be different. And you know, it provided a number of challenges as far as the construction was concerned, you know, because basically, you know, it's Walt alone, you know, without any of his resources that he usually has to work with. I mean, not even just his badge and his, you know, and his wallet with his badge in it like that, but you know, to even know who he is or why he's there or what his purpose is, you know, I mean, he's got to find out, you know, all of those things like that before he can even go further, you know, into this investigation, like that, and then the fact that, you know, that something's wrong in this world that he's in. Consistently, every time he looks to see what time it is, it's 8:17 p.m., and every number that comes up, whether it's a seat number in a theater, whether it's a hotel room or whatever, everything is 31, 31, 31. So there are clues that are provided, maybe that he's providing for himself, you know, subconsciously, like to try and give him a fighting chance to survive, you know, in this situation. But, you know, the one thing that does come across is, through, you know, throughout the book, even though he doesn't know who he is, even if he doesn't know where he is or why he is or any of these things, like that, he does seem to have a moral code. He does seem to have this this North Star of what is right and what is wrong, like that, and it seems to hold him in good stead in this situation, where the footing is, you know, not so steady, as far as that's concerned, and that was an interesting situation to put myself in. The other that, you know, not a lot of people have noted like that is that there are sequences of the book that don't have Walt in them. Mm-hmm. And that hasn't been the case in 17 previous books. Walt's in every single scene. you know, for 17 years, and all of a sudden there are scenes that don't have Walt in them anymore. And they're written in third person, which is something unique for me too, like that, because the Walt books are written in first person for a couple of different reasons. The first one being that I think that there's an energy to that type of storytelling. Like the best example I can think of is Call Me Ishmael. You know, you've got an energy that goes with that kind of storytelling. Some of the best stories I've ever heard in my entire life have been first person, where somebody says, you know, let me tell you what happened to me. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of the way I write the books, almost as if you were sitting in the Busy Bee Cafe and you were to come in and sit down on a stool next to Walt Longmire, and he were to turn to you and say, let me tell you what happened to me last month. Like that. From that point on, I don't want you to even remember that you're reading a book. Right. I want you to fall into that world and be a part of it. And with this particular book, you know, I kind of broke out of that a little bit with the third person. And, you know, there we've got those characters, you know, that are looking desperately to try and find Walt, but he's not there. So it put me in a different place to write, and I had a grand time doing that too, I got to admit.
Which gets us back to what you said about this being somewhat of a departure. And mm-hmm. there's a moment, I think, between a maid who's Scottish having a conversation with some children who live in the boarding school. Mm-hmm. It's New Year's Eve, they're going out, and she said, be cautious. And she starts warning them about this sort of Scottish boogeyman.
Right.
And then one of the boys says, I know exactly what you're talking about, but it's this.
Right.
This is not a monster book. It specifically says it's not a monster, but there is a force mm-hmm. that is what many people would call otherworldly. Mm-hmm. Other people would say that's just, you know, the Cheyenne people might just say that's not otherworldly, that's this world.
Right.
And you're venturing into this area of dealing with folktale, myth, mm-hmm. story, magic realism, but none of those things, because it's reality mm-hmm. in the story and in the culture. Tell me a little bit about what that has to offer a writer like you, who's looking at different forms of truth, different forms of reality.
Well, I think that, you know, when you live in Indian country, like that, you know, mm-hmm. to completely, you know, abandon them and leave them out of your books is not an accurate representation of, you know, who we are and where we are. You know, so for me, it's very important for that to be an aspect, you know, to the storylines. And I knew that when I first started, even with the first book, The Gold Dish, I knew there had to be a spirituality. I mean, I love writing in layers. I love putting as many layers in the books as I possibly can. And for me, the joy of that also is that, like, corner out of your, you know, the corner of your eye kind of thing, where you're not really sure if that happened or not. We're not really mm-hmm. sure if that was real or not, like that, because, you know, in many ways, that's the way it's presented, I think, in real life. And so with Walt, you know, I think that he's, you know, a creature of empirical data, like it, just simply because mm-hmm. he is a detective. And so to drop back, you know, into the old phrase, you know, nothing but the facts, nothing but the facts. But, you know, these things keep intruding into his life. Like, even if he doesn't believe, he has a respect, you know, for the belief system like that, and knows that, you know, that it's the same kind of thing. Like, whenever I'm standing around a campfire, you know, up in Lodge Grass, like that, or up in Lame Deer, like that, with my good buddy Marcus Red Thunder, who's kind of the model for Henry in the books, like, I'm kind of aware that my kind of people have only been in this part of the world for a couple of hundred years, or have actually been here for a couple thousand. And so it might be that they might know a little bit more about what's going on around us than we do. And so that's kind of the position that I put Walt in. And with this one particularly, it was Charles, like that, who I'd mentioned earlier, like that, who told me the story. And I was sitting on his porch, like that, and it was late in the afternoon, the sun was going down, and you know, the kids were playing, his grandkids were playing out past the corral towards a canyon edge, and he was like yelling at him to come back, like that. And he used a term that I'd never heard before, the Evo Etse Heo Mese. And as soon as he mentioned that, those kids came running back, like that. And so I thought that was something important, like that. And so I asked him, I said, what is this phrase that you just used? And he goes, oh, it's just a boogeyman. It's just a boogeyman to scare the kids and make them come back home, like that, you know, when they get out and go too far and all that. And I was like, oh, okay. And so I went home, like that, and started doing a little bit of research, you know, and, you know, all I could discover was the literal translation of the word, which meant wandering without, which I thought was extraordinarily compelling. And, you know, as an author, you know, this is gold. Look at, and so the next time I saw him was at a basketball game up in Lame Deer, and I went over to him, and I said, "Hey, Charles, I said, I've been thinking about that Evo Etse Haumese. Like, I was just wondering, have you ever thought about where it came from? Have you ever thought about where the legend of it, you know, could have, you know, evolved or anything like that?" And he goes, "You know, I have. Like, I have, because I knew the next time I saw you, you would ask me that." Like, so I said, "Well, guilty as charged." Like, and he said, "You know, I've got a theory on that." And he says, "It goes back way, way back." Like, because he said, "I remember my grandparents, you know, using that term." And he said, "The thing that that I came up with was," he says, "you know, back in the day, our people didn't have prisons. Our people didn't have police forces or anything like that." He says, "If you did something that was bad enough, you know, that you were deemed as being unfit, you know, for being, you know, in the company of, you know, the human beings, like that," and he said, "you know, you got banished." Like that. He says, "That was the ultimate, you know, form of punishment, was to be banished." And he said, "And it was a death sentence, is what it was." He said, "A human being out alone at that period in time," he said, "you didn't last very long." Like that. And he said, "I couldn't help but think that all of those souls out there in the wilderness, you know, that had succumbed, you know, looking for some kind of companionship, some kind of connection, you know," he said, "wouldn't they have all like banded together, you know, to make this thing, you know, that went out and looked, you know, for more human beings like it to take with them?" And I was like, "Ew, that's just a little bit scary." Like, and I thought that probably would, you know, work into this situation that seems to be happening with Walt. And so
it's just a little bit scary.
Yeah, it
definitely
is.
Definitely.
Yeah. But it's interesting though, because like you said, it's not really, you know, it's not really a monster like that, because
right.
I don't want to give too much away, which is always the trick in these situations.
Yes,
like
right.
But there are times when Walt's actually, you know, conversing with this entity, and this entity is trying to explain to him, "Look, all I'm trying to do is give you everything you want. That's all I'm trying to do.
Yeah.
I'm trying to stop your suffering and give you everything that you want." You know, and
it's for Walt Longmire.
Yeah.
Read the book to find
out
what it is that we think that a man of his occupation and 17 books in might want at this point. This is a moment which I don't think we need to describe, because it would probably give a few things away. But a character is saying, "Maybe this was the true hell of things, to be an unwilling witness to events, but to be unable to stop them apart from opening and closing shutters." What's your definition of hell?
That would be close to what it is, like to be constantly feeling, you know, that empathy, but not having the ability to do something about it. You know, not actually having the opportunity to step in and be able to make those changes, you know, a helplessness, like a, you know, a psychic, you know, kind of helplessness, especially concerning people that you love and care about. It would be terrible to be trapped in that kind of a situation. And with Walt, you know, I mean, he's very active. He's very hands-on. And for him, he likes solving these problems and making people's lives better. You know, that's one of the main reasons that he does what he does. You know, whenever I do, you know, when I was doing a lot of initial interviews with a lot of like Western sheriffs, and you know, one of the phrases I kept hearing from them was "my people, my people." You know, there's a connection there, like that, and it's actually one of the reasons why it was that I chose, you know, Walt to be a sheriff, was simply because, you know, one of the greatest things that you can give anybody is your vote, you know, and the fact that, you know, Walt is an elected, you know, law enforcement official, which is interesting because whenever I'm overseas and trying to explain that, they look at me like I'm crazy. They're like, "You elect a police officer?" And I'm like, "Yeah." They're like, "You're nuts. Like, that can't possibly work." And I was like, "Well, sometimes it doesn't. Like, sometimes it does." Like, but that gives a connection, I think, you know, between the community and, you know, and Walt. Like, I mean, Walt's not the guy in the chrome sunglasses, you know, driving around in a unit glaring at everybody. He's the guy that, you know, there are people that will go into a sheriff's office like that and ask questions and ask something from a sheriff that will never walk into a police office in their entire lives, like that, simply because there's a connection there to that community. And, you know, when I was starting the series of books, I thought, I want Walt really connected to this community, really connected to these people, you know, for it to work. And that, you know, kind of like puts Walt in that position where he needs to do things for people and solve problems, and you know, to be in a position where he can't, you know, that just, you know, it would be horrific for him.
One of the themes of this book, there are themes of regret and love, but also distraction. And I found that to be very compelling as I was reading it, to the point where you would just, you know, I would catch myself and think, this is for me right now. What are you missing in life when you are distracted? We live in an age of profound distraction. What's the role of fiction in bringing us home.
Well, I think, you know, you used that word, truth. Like, you know, it's always looking for, you know, a literary truth. And, you know, that you know, great, you know, quote from Steinbeck, which kind of goes a little bit back to as far as, like, the universality is concerned, like that, you know, his statement on getting the Nobel Prize for Literature was, is that, you know, good literature approaches a universality of the human nature. Like, it's what it is that you're shooting for, what you're trying to find, something that we all have in common. And I think that, you know, with Walt, that's something I'm going to be, you know, searching for, you know, in each book, which is a bit of a challenge like that. But yeah, I think in the contemporary world, you know, it's all kind of like technologically driven. I mean, and Walt is so anti-technology like that. I mean, the weapons that he uses are the weapons he used in the, you know, Vietnam War in the 1960s, for goodness sake. He can't use a cell phone. He doesn't know how like that. You know, he doesn't have a computer. Or more importantly, he had a computer and they took it away from him because it was turning into a situation which was more work for them than just having, you know, do his emails for him. But the difficulty that we have, like it is that everything in technology is driven to make us go faster and for everything to go faster. And sometimes that's not the answer. You know, sometimes, like, and I think, you know, certainly in Indian culture, it's much more of a situation of slowing down and seeing the world and being a part of it rather than, you know, having those moments and times, which are the moments that make up our lives, you know, kind of taken away from us by that technology. So, you know, it's always, and that's a writer's job too. You know, one of your jobs, like that, is to slow down and point things out. And in many ways, that's kind of like, you know, Walt's job too, is to slow down and maybe notice things that nobody else does. And I think the two kind of dovetail pretty well as far as, like, you know, whenever you're trying to write a novel with him at the center of it.
It is an incredible read, and it is a wild adventure, and the action sequences, I can't think of another writer who's writing action sequences. I'm convinced that you're acting these out in, you know, your living room or where your writing studio or your backyard or whatever, rolling around on the ground because everything just makes sense and pulls so suspenseful.
Thank you.
I want to make time for some audience questions to make sure if anybody has something they would like to ask Craig Johnson, they certainly can.
Since you brought up the law enforcement and the difference, which I had never thought about before, what is your background in law enforcement? I see that on your bio. Were you a sheriff? Were you a police?
No. I mean, and the thing about sheriffing is that it's a very specific style of law enforcement, you know? I mean, it's not only, you know, like I was saying, as far as, like, you know, you're elected. You know, so not only do you have to be a police officer, you have to be a politician, too. And, you know, we don't really get into that a whole lot in the books like that, but obviously that's the part of the job that scares Walt to death like that because he's just not something that he's, you know, particularly good at. And so he has to be careful as far as that type of thing is concerned. But then you also look at, you know, the size of, you know, I mean, it's always a little, you know, interesting because, you know, there's eccentric circles that go out, you know, from Absaroka County. You know, and there are people that get certain things because they're right there in the Bighorn Mountains. You know, there are some people that get things because they're in, you know, the Northern High Plains, like that as a whole. And it just goes out and out and out and out. Like that. But one of the things I'm always trying to explain is that, you know, I mean, we have counties in Wyoming, and it's the same here, you know, in South Dakota, too, where you have counties as big as Maryland, you know. And these, you know, sheriff's departments have extraordinarily limited funds, have extraordinarily limited staff, you know, to be able to try and enforce, you know, the laws and those type of things. The other thing is like the many layers that you're responsible for. I mean, you're really kind of responsible for everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of times when you read some of these books, like, and the characters are, like, say, a homicide investigator or something like that, you're going to carry a heavy caseload, like, out of a lot of homicides, but that's all you do is just those homicides. Like, and then you've got, you know, of course, you know, a burglary department that's in charge of robberies and things like that. But everybody's got all of these different sections. Like, sheriffs don't have that luxury. You're pretty much in charge of everything. And so it would be hard for me to have that kind of experience to draw from. Like, and so I knew early on when I wrote the first two chapters of The Cold Dish, they were horrible. And I remember thinking, why are they as bad as they are? Like that, and I thought, you know what? You don't know anything about rural sheriffing. You better go find out about it and see how these guys do what they do. Look at, and they all, of course, have very, very different styles and very, very different ways of what it is that they do. There are some who are extraordinarily, I've done a lot of talks like at the National Sheriff's Association meetings, like and the different, the assortment of guys that you meet that are doing that job from all over the country. I mean, some of them come in and they're wearing a suit, you know, and they would never put one of these on like to save their life. Like, and then the next guy walks in, has a handlebar mustache, it comes out past his ears. Like, you know, and so it's a very, very, you know, group of individuals, you know. And so for me, that was the key element, you know, to try and find out as much as I could about that. Like, and over the years, I've found out a lot more. But the going out and doing those interviews was the best thing to really kind of give me the input that I needed. I mean, I remember asking, well, Larry Kirkpatrick, who was the sheriff there in Johnson County, and he had pigeon on his shoulders because he had been the sheriff for so long, like that, you know, there were statues of him, for goodness sake. And I remember he read the first chapter of The Cold Dish, and he says, you got a mistake right there in the first chapter. And I said, what's that? Like that, and he goes, you got people drinking beer out of bottles on a bar out on the Powder River. He says, it's can-only bars on the Powder River crack. And I was like, why is it can-only bars on the Powder River? He says, because they throw bottles at each other and hurt each other. And I took a pause, and I looked at him. I said, well, Larry, if you throw a full can of beer at somebody, you could hurt them. Like, there's this long pause where he's staring at me, and he goes, Craig, nobody on the Powder River ever threw a full can of beer. You know? So it's still a learning process that I'm going through. Like that, but yeah, it's been kind of like, you know, an enjoyment factor for it too, I have to admit.
So. Oh, it's delightful.
Well, I just love his connections, his family, his friends. That is the core of the books.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
And it continues on.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, those relationships have to evolve. Like that, they really, really do. Like that, and like I was saying, as far as like an ensemble, you know, of the characters is concerned, you know, there's always going to be, you know, some characters will depart, like that, and then others will come in. And it's interesting to see, you know, what those relationships, how they're going to pan out, what direction they go in, you know, how they're going to evolve. Like that. The big thing for me, like I was saying before, like that is that, you know, I there are a couple of things I take into consideration whenever I'm thinking about a new book. I get that question a lot. You know, it's like, how do you decide what the next book is going to be? Like that, and one of the guilty pleasures I can tell you about here is that I you know, when I'm watching TV, when I'm listening to the radio, when I'm reading newspapers, I'm always listening for stories that I think, you know, are potential Walt Longmire, you know, catalysts. You know, that might be something that'll spark something like that gets the idea going. Well, that's a plot, you know, but that, you know, you have to have the characters in the right place, you know, for it, you know, to work. And then there are a couple other things too, like that I take into consideration. A lot of people don't know that the books are written in a cyclical manner in that each book has a season. And so it takes four books to get through 1 year of Walt's life. You know, this book is winter, and so the next book will probably be spring. Like, I mean, I follow the I call it a Vivaldi is what I call it, right. The four seasons. Like, and so, and what that does is it provides me with a completely different environ for each book too. Mm-hmm. You know, but the difficulty with that is that the storyline has to kind of work, you know, with whatever season it is that I happen to be. And if I happen to have a book that's about, say, rodeo. You can't have that in the winter, okay, unless you're going to go to Las Vegas or something like that. Like, and so I have to take those kind of things into consideration whenever I'm writing the books. You know, the good news is that, you know, with it taking four books to get through 1 year of Walt's literary life, Walt has actually only aged about 5 years since we first met him. Like, and it's been a hectic 5 years, yeah. I have to admit that, but he's only 5 years older than
Walt. Give Walt
when we
a break. That's
him.
Why people are emailing
I know, and telling me to knock it off. Like, you know, and, but I, you know, here I am. Like, at some point in time, I'm going to be older than Walt. And I don't know if I like that idea, you know, so much. Like, but it's those kind of things you kind of take into consideration, like that, you know, like where the characters are in their relationships. You know, how is this going to, you know, change things? Like, yeah, there's a big change coming up in the next book. Like, and this will be the first time that I can give the title out. It's called Proud Flesh, is what it's called. Like, and for those who don't know, it's a veterinarian term for when a horse has a wound on its leg. Like, a lot of times the tissue will grow back in without a nervous system involved. Like, and so what you have to do is, and it's so they can get them back on their feet quickly enough so that they can save themselves from being dinner. And the problem is you have to carve that proud flesh out to be able to allow actual working tissue to come back in. And this is an old term that sheriffs used to use back in the day. They used to call, you know, whenever an investigation had taken a turn for proud flesh. And I was talking to an old sheriff about it, and I said, what does that mean? I know what the horse term means, but what does that mean in an investigation? He says, that means when you start packing your investigation with all the wrong answers, like that, you know, and then get towards finding the real answers, you're going to have to take all those bad answers back out again. You know, I thought, oh, that's just too good to pass up. Like, and so, but in that one, like, there's an important twist, you know, in the development of the characters and their relationships. You know, it's kind of core to the books, like that. So that's something to look forward to.
You heard it here first.
And that's the way it works. You ask me a question, it takes me 10 minutes to answer, just so you know. Like
this
so,
just in. Anything else that anybody wants to, one more? Yeah.
What was your catalyst for Grace Slick in one of your novels? Did you have a crush on her in college like a lot of us did?
Oh, my goodness. Okay, let's see. The instance he's referring to is actually in Western Star, and it's the part where Walt is taking a train, like at, you know, across, you know, South Dakota, and you know, it was kind of interesting to me, like at, you know, think about, you know, who Walt would run into at that point in time, and I thought, you know, it's the late 60s, early 70s, like at, and I thought, you know, what was that? That was a period of like rock and roll, like that, you know, and so, you know, and I thought, well, what's Walt gonna have to do with that, like, and then I thought, what rock groups were on tour and drove across Wyoming? And so I literally tracked down which rock and roll groups would have been on buses traveling across Wyoming at that period in time. And what I discovered was that Jefferson Airplane had actually done a tour and had finished up in Times Square, like in Central Park in New York, and had, you know, driven on a bus. They didn't fly. They drove on the bus all the way back, you know, to San Francisco. Well, that took them right across Wyoming, right at the silent, or the exact period in time that I needed. Like, and so I wrote that in there, like, and I thought, you know, let Walt meet somebody. And Walt always bounces off of women. You know, it's always, there's always a little bit more, you know, there, like that, you know, and that might be me, like that. I mean, I you know, I have a wife and two daughters and a granddaughter, like that, and I really enjoy female company. I think it's the most wonderful thing in the world. Maybe I've spent too much time, you know, playing football and, you know, being in masculine company and things like that, but with this one, like that, I thought this might work, and so I wrote the scene, like that, and I was pretty happy about it. And, you know, it's always a dicey proposition when you take a big celebrity like that and put them in your book. I mean, you know, I never say that it's Grace Slick. She just says her name is Grace. Like that, and there, you know, and then there's that part, I think, where Lucian says, what's Jefferson's airplane? And, well, you know, who owns Jefferson's airplane? What's Jefferson's airplane got to do with it anyway? Like, but it was kind of funny, like, because I've got a good friend out in California who was a federal judge, and he's kind of a shaker and a mover in that, like, you know, in that Haight-Ashbury, you know, San Francisco world. Like, and so there was a package that came one day, and it was a FedEx package overnight. And I get it, and I open it up, and it was my book. It was you know, Western Star. And I thought, well, I guess somebody sent it back to me to sign it, you know, and send it off to him. Like, and so I, you know, pick it up, like, and I flip through to the title page, like, and somebody else had signed my book. And by golly, like, it was Grace Slick. Grace Slick had signed it, and she sent it back to me. And there's a part in the book where, how am I going to phrase this and be able to get this on the air? There's a part in the book where she complains to Walt, like, that there were two things that she always wanted to do. She always wanted to ride a horse and Jimi Hendrix. And I think Walt's response is, I think I might be able to help you with the horse. You know, and so whenever Grace Slick wrote me back, she said, I know Walt Longmire isn't real, but what if he was, I would him. Oh. I took as a positive, you know, review. Like, and I thought that was probably a good thing. I guess so.
No higher compliment from Grace Slick.
There you have it. The first time anybody's ever said, on the South Dakota Public Television.
From here on out, it will always be, Well, This has been such a delight. Thank you so much for coming and have a fabulous time at the Mickelson Library tonight.
Thank you. This has been a magnificent interview. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's do this again, for goodness sake. Like, either side of the state. Doesn't matter to me.
I'll come to you.
Okay, yeah, there
you
go. Deal.
Thank you very much. We appreciate your time. Thanks for stopping by the studio.
My pleasure. And I do. My hat.